This is my co-speaker Karan Rudeja. He is a UX designer from Globant.
Hi everybody. We would like you to please put your phones on silent. That is, don't switch them off. Just put them on silent and sit back, enjoy, and we hope you like this sensorial ride. So if you have anything in your hands by any chance, just keep it aside for a second. Yeah, release your hands. And then just sit back, calm yourself down, settle down. Close your eyes. Breathe out. Hear my voice. Hear the sounds inside the room. Feel your hands. Join your hands. Breathe in. Breathe out. Thanks a lot. Now you can open your eyes. Now you'll find this little peanut or groundnut that may have been given to you. We'd like you to eat it. So this small little daily object that we find called the groundnut or the peanut, Hindi mein they call it moongfali. It's very interesting because it's got color, texture, it's got this certain form, you can feel it in your hands. When you open it up, it's got this sound and you can smell it and of course eat it. So basically this small little object is in a way reaching out to all your senses. Next thing what we have is a small sense test that we'll try to do with you. What we are going to do is that I'll show you a small video. A syllable is going to get repeated, then I'm going to ask you what you are hearing and you can tell me with the show of your hands. Never mind this, so let's skip to the part where it goes like ba, 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 ba. So what were you actually hearing? The first or the second one? This is the first or the second one, can you please tell me? Right, so next one, ba, 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 ba. Was it the first or the second one? Right. I'll do the first one again. I'll try. I hope I can do it as well as this guy did. But I want you to close your eyes. Pa, 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 pa. Open your eyes. What were you hearing?
The second one, eh?
So that's what happens. Like the human senses are a little complex and you were getting information coming to your eyes through my lip movement as well as the sound that was reaching your ears. And what happens is that when the brain is competing for both these information, it wants to make sense of what is happening in the environment and it immediately jumps to conclusion. So you think that I'm saying wah, but actually I was saying ba. It's the same syllable. This effect is called the McGurk effect.
So we have another small thing that we can try. So you will find a small candy on your seat or next to your seat. So if you can just please open it and so this might be a bit uncomfortable. So what you need to do is you need to close your nose and without breathing, chew the candy for like a few seconds and then open your nose. So you might feel that once you open your nose, there is a difference in the sense of flavor that you have. So what happens is that what we often think of as taste is a combination of what we actually taste and what we smell. So these two little things are just to illustrate the point that when as children we are taught that we have five senses and they have their own individual functions. But actually the perceptions that we have are actually made of multiple senses. So what you see affects what you hear also. So this is, go to the next slide.
Next thing is a short story that I'll tell you which happened recently in my family, and that was the moment when I got this realization that, you know, the senses are actually quite important to us and they affect, you know, decision making. My dad wanted to buy a dining table and he had this thing in mind, like you see in hotels which have a stone top, and he was really crazy about it, running after it. And one day all of us went to the mall, he found this dining table, he was very excited, he almost pounced on it, sat down. And few minutes later, he comes to me and tells me that I like this dining table, but I'm not going to buy it. And I asked him why. He said that when I sat on it and I kept my hands on it, my forearms felt cold, so I don't want to buy it. And that was the moment where I realized that, you know, the sense of touch and the temperature was something that completely, entirely changed the decision of going for that table. And that's when I felt that, you know, these senses are a lot more important and we shouldn't probably take them for granted. So let me take you back a little in time. Suppose these are the cavemen children, we can probably call them Boogas for now. And their senses were very, like, you know, good and proficient in comparison to ours, because their survival depended on these senses, and because they would get, like, you know, attacked by predators and all, so they would always have to be on high alert, and that's where these senses help him. Moving, like, fast forwarding in time, we have the Zonaks. So Zonaks are the people like us, the civilized kinds, the ones who are living in these urban, artificially designed environments. We don't have threats from predators, nobody is coming and attacking us. And that's why we may have seen that, you know, our dependency on the various senses has kind of gone down, which I'll elaborate through this graph. This is called the bandwidth of senses, which is showing us that we are heavily dependent on sight, then touch, hearing, smell, and finally taste. This is also showing the amount of information that your brain is getting at any particular second, where sight being the maximum, followed by the other senses. And with this, we can see that, you know, since this study was done on people like us, like Zonaks, we can in a way infer that because of this dependency and the way the biological evolution is happening, the way design is also proceeding is also changing, which is why we are seeing this heavy reliance on screens, and interaction design seems to be chasing screens for some reason.
Okay, so for last, I think, few months, like 6 months or 8 months, we have been like exploring this domain of alternate senses. And so so we came across this interesting way of analyzing our daily interactions in terms of what senses they are catering to. So if you go to the next slide. So this is the graph of cooking. So you can see that cooking as an act involves all the senses. So there is like sight, touch, smell. Whereas if you look at something like driving, so it's heavily dependent on sight and sound and also maybe on touch. Piggy bank is something very interesting where it's not really dependent on sight as such, but you can sort of pick it up and feel the weight of the piggy bank, or shake it and hear the sound, and that sound and the weight informs you of the contents inside and the quantity inside. Then if you look at any of the mobile applications, so most of them are obviously dependent on sight and maybe slightly on sound.
Just one last thing I want to add here is that, so using this graph, you can actually see whatever you're designing, what all sensor does it map to. Now, designing for the other senses.
Yeah, so so for this, we have a couple of interesting examples that we that illustrate how we can design with other senses. So this is one of the projects that caters to majorly to the sense of taste. This is a project that we both worked on along with two other people.
Okay, we are super sorry, the video isn't playing because of some technical glitch. Gaurav, you can talk about it.
Okay, so what this project does is that, so right now we are like creating a lot of digital information through like our fitness bands and our mobile applications and every transaction that we do on payment portals. So, so we are thinking about how this data can be experienced by people, not just through numbers or through like emails, but through some other sense. So. So this is a project called Data Jalebi Bot, where it is a bot which asks you a certain information about you. Let's say you are attending a conference, so it asks you certain questions like, what are you here for? What do you do? Like, are you a designer? Are you an engineer? These kinds of things, and it takes that information and converts it into an abstract form, which is then printed in the form of a jalebi, which is an edible Indian sweet that is actually like then fried and dipped in sugar syrup, and then you end up consuming it. So the idea is to in a way, in an abstract form, consume the data through taste, through smell, through touch, and not just through sight.
I would have really enjoyed all of you seeing this video, because that's where you actually get the essence of the project. And if you actually want to see it happening in real, please come to Design Up. That's where we are showcasing on the 10th and 11th of November. This project was initially showcased at Interact 2017, which was a recent HCI conference in Mumbai. And this is Hitachi. They're using Hitachi projectors. Yes, we have. You can also check out the website, it's datajalebi.com. Meanwhile, Windows. We have in this trend experiment that we are trying to investigate alternative ways of data consumption. But up to now we have served about 300 plus people. It has been a fun journey because people, you know, come provide their data. It can be their professional profile. The project was trying to capture the interaction pattern that people have when they come to conferences, and they just like have a simple conversation and they would exchange, like it's a small talk that happens. So I'd probably come and say, hi Surbhi, I'm Karan Dadeja, and I work as a UX designer out here, and this is like I've worked for about 2.5 years or something, my interest areas are so and so forth, and I'm here as a presenter or a visitor. So she gets a certain idea of who I am. And in this project data delivery, what we've done, the same thing where this entire profile gets captured, and then it is in a way represented using a visualization which is borrowing the aesthetics from the patterns of rangolis and mandalas, which are in a way integrated to the Indian culture. Data delivery bot, this is the graph that would happen for like you can see that it, since it's a food related project, it will be, you know, equally you know, high on parameters for all the senses. Next project that I will show you is sonic bells. This was a project which in which the person has this a small weight, and they're trying to show that there is this couple of activities that we do on our daily lives. They've taken the example of exercising, where so you can see that the activities that she's doing. And the sounds that are being created by the phone, they allow us and the group to understand. So for this project, this would be the mapping where sight and touch are heavy, and so is sound. Okay, smell of data. This is a project where people, what they've done is that they've taken this idea that whenever gas leaks happen and people can't see it, they would induce a little bit of an artificial smell inside so that people know that there is some sort of a threat or a danger. And they've taken the same context and applied it to how we have, you know, our computers connected to the net, and we are in a way potentially, possibly, in a, like, you know, we can get attacked by threats or viruses attacks. So this small device, whenever it senses that, you know, you're getting attacked, it releases fragrance. And cryoscope, this is the final project, where what it does is that there's a small aluminium box and it is connected to the...
The cryoscope is a haptic weather forecasting device. It consists of an aluminum cube which is heated or cooled to tomorrow's forecasted temperature.
What is the forecast going to be like?
So users enter their location into a web app. The cube then automatically adjusts to the forecasted temperature.
Again, it would be very high on touch. And now you would want to know that why are we like advocating this entire thing of designing for the senses? Because we feel that, as you saw in the previous framework of the graph, that once your senses are being mapped in through the project, it will become a lot more engaging, a lot more immersive, and a lot more experiential.
So now the part about how actually we can go about doing this. So you might say that, okay, this is interesting, but if we are to design with other senses, how can we do that? So so now the thing is, we have spent a lot of time understanding how the sense of sight works, and a lot of psychology and like cognitive psychology has like done research on that. But we have to understand that the other senses are fundamentally different from how sight works. So if you have to design for them, there will be certain different things that we should keep in mind. And also, one of the good things is that the other senses allow us a certain key advantages that sight does not have. For example, the other senses, like unlike sight where we are only seeing what is in front of our eyes, something like smell or something like sound is something that we always hear wherever it's coming from. So we can actually utilize something like that nature of the senses and communicate information through, let's say, smell while you are already engaged on a screen. So you don't have to break your flow to sort of comprehend that new information that is coming to you. Then the second thing is that this is in a way a limitation because our sense of sight is so tuned to understanding so much information. The other senses are not that trained in accessing information. So we have to keep in mind that if you're trying to communicate something through, let's say, smell, it should be very simple, something like binary states of right versus wrong or success versus failure. For example, something like success of a payment process or success of order can be communicated through a pleasant smell, whereas failure can be communicated through unpleasant smell, which is something that is happening in the background in a slightly abstract manner. Then the third thing is that as we saw in the beginning, that all our perceptions are actually made of multiple senses. So we can also think of designing for screens where there is maybe like one or two additional senses which are complementing what is happening on the screen. So the fourth thing is natural mapping. So Karan will now turn on the Bluetooth speaker. And now we'll turn it off. So you can see even without knowing anything about the speaker, you can know, you can detect which one is the turning on sound and which one is turning off, because it is catering to certain basic human understanding of rise and fall in the pitch of the voice, the sound. So we have to be mindful of these associations that we have. For example, smell is something that is very subjective. So you have to be aware of these associations and design in sync with that.
We'll skip the ideas because we're short on time.
Yeah.
We hope some of this as a primer to designing for the other senses made sense to all of you. Thanks a lot for your attention. I'm Karan. And this is Gaurav. We are postgraduates from New Media Design NID. Hope you have a nice day and enjoy the sessions. See you.
Thank you so much.